Tejada. I was supervised to the faithfulness and the payment of treasure. I supervised to the enlightenment of wisdom to the world. I supervised to have the inner faith, deep understanding. I supervised to the divine. And this integration of the savings thought will be about the real love of intellectual wisdom. And one of the reasons of giving this talk this evening was I'm planning to learn article in one of the newsletters. I just recall that this idea of the middle way in wisdom is something which is not so well understood, especially by the lay Buddhist community. And even by the monastic Buddhist community, who actually is this middle way, which was the purpose of the Buddha. Because even as a monk meditated,
we have to make torches out of wood or glass, which is
sometimes serve with the fact that the sun trees, which would be able to ignite very easily, such as the pine and the yarn tree. And those torches I would use to make it through the dark nights. However, even though there was some gratification in there, there was also the danger, and the danger with a glass torch was when there's a wind comes, and God is a very flame in your face and burns you. And that's the uncertainty of said two pressures. They seem to be working in your favor now, all under the wind changes, and it grows in your face and burns you. It says to be glad to have your partner, will be uncertain if permanent, and we can't pull out. Eventually, the wind changes, and God's parties get burnt. A wife who seeks for their happiness in food or another sexuality. And always be surprised when God gets frustrated and disappointed. And there will be no happiness there, but frustration and wind blows out of the opposite direction. And in that sense, the sensual world is not a piece of meat picked up by a bird. As soon as one bird in the outboat picks up something, the other bird is fighting it to try and get it. And so the whole bird is picking up a piece of meat. Well, and it's helped by others. So true pleasure is the cause of envy and jealousy in this world. It was like just throwing the door a bird just covered with crumbs with no meat on it. In other words, the dog gets a taste of pleasure. He gets a taste of food. The hungry dog gets a lick of taste of blood. But that's what it is. It doesn't get anything else, no nourishment. How much torture that is. That's a beautiful symbol which the Lord gave for sensory pleasure. He promised the grass from the city taste. The goal of the sensuality, but as soon as he tasted it, he disappeared. And it's gone. And it's one of the Scottish poets called the poet that is like a snowflake in the river. The snow that falls in the river, the snowflake disappears, gone forever. And this is why there's a really hungry dog trying to taste. It's that little bit of the bird and thinks it's got its food about. It's a taste there, but nothing substantial. The tendency doesn't want to be frustrated. A promise which is never fulfilled. It's like taking out a loan. This is one of my favorite surveys of sensory pleasures. And as the more sensory pleasure you indulge in, the more you need to have off this interest. You may have heard me say here before that pleasure and love and five senses is measured by the way of starting which way before it comes afterwards. There's another thing. The hard work, and then you finally get what you want. A degree of hard work, effort, sacrifice, struggle, which we mentioned before, is the measure of the happiness which you receive afterwards. That's one of the happiest people which people see. The people who win their sporting competition, the person who wins the gold medal at the Olympics, who wins the tennis tournament. The amount of struggle that people have gone through to get to that podium,